Welcome to Frank Buckley Interviews. This time on the program, it's Dateline's Josh Mankiewicz.
What's going on?
My husband, and he's been shot in the head, please.
His true crime stories on Dateline are riveting, each one like a mystery movie. But the murders really happened. How do the stories come together? Why are we so fascinated? It's Josh Mankiewicz on 25 Years with Dateline. Josh, welcome to the program.
Thank you.
25 years. You're coming up next month in February.
Yeah. Please.
Can you believe it?
No, it went by like that.
It did. I mean, it's amazing, though, that you started out as a, I don't want to say a proper journalist, but a TV reporter who covered...
I was a political reporter for a lot of my career. We met when both working here at a different station in Los Angeles. I was covering politics then. And I ended up at Dateline at a time when we were doing all kinds of different stories, not just crime. And then about 10, 12 years into it, so about half the time I've been at Dateline, we started doing these hour-long murder mysteries and true crime, which I wasn't terribly interested in at the beginning, but then I did one. And I'm still in touch with the family from that case.
Is that right?
Yeah. So then sort of something that I think no one suspected, maybe our bosses did, but I didn't see this coming. It caught on with the audience in a way we could never have guessed.
No, it is amazing, and I find myself as a member of that audience riveted. I tune in, and you always do it to us. You have these lines that keep us going. We think we've solved it.
Right.
And then you take a turn and you take us in a different direction.
Well, we're looking for stories, you know, we're not looking for the bloodiest story. We're not looking for the scariest story. We're looking for a story that's got some twists and turns in it. And the template is more sort of like a Law and Order episode where you think you know who it is, and then you think you know who it is after that, and then it turns out it's the next door neighbor.
Yeah.
And we don't begin stories by saying, here's a guy who was accused of killing his wife, but it turned out to be the guy living next door. Now stay tuned for 59 minutes or an hour and 59 minutes. Depending on the episode, we lead you through it. Yeah. And that's the fun of it. That's the fun of the storytelling, as well as telling a story that isn't fun, that's deadly serious and frequently really important.
Well, and I was just going to say, it is fun in the sense that it is storytelling and that as an audience, we are, I don't want to say enjoying it, but we're along for the ride on this story.
We try very hard, and this is a team effort. I mean, the real value in Dateline are all the people that you don't see on camera. Mm-hmm. But we draw a very sharp line between the storytelling and the story. The storytelling is kind of fun as you lead people around corners and suggest that you know, maybe this guy's guilty, maybe this guy's guilty. Police had this person as a suspect. Oh, it turns out they were exonerated. So that's one thing. The story itself, those aren't funny at all. Those are deadly serious, and frequently they say something about criminal justice or relationships between men and women or the way the criminal justice system operates, because it's generally not the way people think, and it's different from the way all of that's portrayed on an hour-long TV drama.
In fact, the two-hour episode that you have coming up in February deals with DNA and how that has become such a part of crime solving, and we have a clip. I want to run it, and then we can talk about it on the other side.
Spent a lot of time concerned that someone had been watching our house, would know all of our moves and our schedules.
That's if it's somebody random. If it's not somebody random, then somebody you know might be a murderer.
Yeah, I think the other unrest is that someone that you've interacted with, that you've shared a drink with, that you've posed in a picture with, could hurt someone like they hurt her.
Is a killer.
Yeah.
And that's from the next program that we're going to see. What? Tell us about that conversation.
This is a story about a murder that occurred about 15 years ago, like 2003, I think it happened, a little more than 15 years ago, in Las Cruces, New Mexico. A young woman leaves a party and is not seen again, and everybody's looking for her, and then she's eventually found, and she's been killed. And there was a long road of the investigative process to kind of get to the end. But intertwined with this is her family's dedication to changing the way the law works so that DNA is collected from people at the time they're arrested instead of at the time that they're convicted. That's now true in, I think there's about 20 states that still do it only at conviction, and some places do it depending on what kind of offense it is that you're arrested for. And a DNA test at the time of arrest would have solved this case a lot sooner. It wouldn't have necessarily prevented that young woman, Katie Sepich, from being killed, but it might have solved her murder probably in 3 months instead of 3 years, which is what it took. And so this story is not just the story of how police and sheriff's investigators solved that murder, but also sort of how her family fought for this change in the law, which they eventually succeeded at.
You talk about the fact that this murder happened many, many years ago. Talk to me about the process of bringing that to the screen. When do you decide this is a story we're going to feature on Dateline, and then what is the process to get to a two-hour program?
Before we decide what we can feature, we always decide sort of what we're going to pursue. We read the papers all over the country every day, and we also get tipped off by local stations and by prosecutors, defense attorneys, and police officers that we've worked with before. And then we start making calls, usually when something happens. Now, we don't air until the case has been adjudicated, in part because, you know, the audience doesn't want a story that ends, you know, so who's going to be arrested or who's guilty? Well, we don't know.
Right.
You know, you want, you know, Bill was convicted. He's doing life. Good night. That's ideally how it ends. But or Bill was acquitted. But at least you want an answer. So additionally, police and prosecutors frequently won't do interviews until after the whole thing's over. And also when it's over, the court file becomes public record. So you can get that 911 call where the person doesn't sound appropriately upset. You can use some of the crime scene photos. Most of them are too gory for us to use on camera, but there's ways to edit around that. So we need all that evidence. We need the videotapes of the person being interrogated by police, and you see them changing their story. This episode with showing a shots of a young woman on a road in Texas, and we never got her. We never did an interview with her. Her whole participation in the Dateline episode was in video supplied by the police, and you saw her story change over time, just as prosecutors and police did. So that's the advantage of that kind of thing. And we go to work assembling all of that stuff and lining up interviews with people right from the beginning. Now, if we go down that road a ways and it turns out the family doesn't want to talk, or in rare cases, police and prosecutors don't want to talk, although that almost never happens, we reevaluate whether or not we're going to be able to go ahead. You don't need everybody to go ahead, but you need nearly everybody.
You're sitting across from these people who often have gone through some very difficult times in their lives. They've lost a loved one. Something horrible has happened in their community. Or in the case of a police officer, they're trying to solve a crime, or they have solved a crime, and they're trying to tell you how it happened. I would imagine a lot of it is building trust with people.
Well, it is, and it's one reason why we're always delighted to work with departments that we worked with before, because there is always some trust there built in. But, you know, generally when you're talking with police officers or investigators, like, you want the sort of tick-tock of the investigation, and you want it kind of in sort of granular detail. I mean, you know, Joseph Wambaugh, who was a police sergeant and lieutenant here in Los Angeles and then went on to write a series of novels, always says that the cases that interest him the most are not the ones where the cops work on the cases. It's the ones about how the cases work on the cops. In terms of families, you're talking to somebody who is describing to you the worst thing that ever happened to them. And frequently, they're not getting a chance anywhere else in journalism to tell it in that kind of detail. And when the story's featured on the local 6 o'clock news, wherever it is in the country, it's not gonna go on for 2 hours. It's gonna go on, if you're lucky, for 2 minutes. So families can give you a lot of detail that otherwise can't be found anywhere else. And you do hear these horrible stories of things that people do to each other. You also hear tremendous stories of strength and persevering and people who are able to pull themselves together from this terrible thing.
All right. We've talked to you about how this affects the people around these crimes. When we come back, I want to talk to you about how it affects you and how you get through covering these grisly stories. More with Josh Mankiewicz when we come back.
And her killer had attempted to burn her corpse.
He did. He had poured some kind of liquid on her, more on her shoulder area and on her back, and then lit it on fire.
That attempt to hide or destroy evidence failed. Instead, the killer or killers left behind a partially nude body, burned and scraped raw.
We're back with Josh Mankiewicz from Dateline, and another scene from the two-hour special that you have coming up in February. And that is such a grisly moment. And, you know, and I just, yeah.
That's one of the officers that I was talking about. The guy in that video, Robert Jones, was a captain with the sheriff's office in the Las Cruces area.
Yeah.
He worked on that case for a long time, and then he was going to retire because he'd been carrying a badge for 25 or 30 years. And his dedication to that case, to solving Katie Sepich's murder, and the bond that he'd built with the Sepich family persuaded him to put off his retirement for a couple of years and keep working the case. That's the kind of thing that we're talking about. That's a theme you see a lot in our stories, is the sort of selfless dedication of law enforcement.
Yeah, and you also see crimes, I would imagine, from the point of view of both the victims' families and the detectives and the prosecutors, which means you're seeing, you literally went to the grisly scene where this horrible thing happened.
We do spend a lot of time at crime scenes, although not at the moment that the body is there, usually, you know, sometime later. But yeah, you do. And the hard part of this job is not interviewing the murderers after they're already locked up. The hard part of this job is talking to those families.
Yeah.
Because the idea that people recover from this and move on is a pleasant contrivance that people have. I mean, this idea that there's something called closure, that you can just, you know, well, he got arrested or he's on death row, and so now we're even. Well, that doesn't happen.
Right.
And so you're talking to people who have been, you know, brutally hurt by the things that happened to them. And you got to strike some kind of balance between starting to cry when they start to cry and also saying to them, hey, come on, we got an interview to do here, knock that off. I mean, you can't do either one.
Yeah.
So you need to have some sort of relationship in which you are listening to their story, but also, you know, I mean, if you're not feeling anything, then you should get out.
But I was talking to you the other day, and I was surprised when you said we're sitting down for a 3-hour interview.
Oh, yeah.
I didn't realize you sat with someone and heard the story and talked to them for that long. That's got to stick in your head.
Oh yeah, it does.
And your heart.
It totally does. No, it's you hear people's stories from beginning to end. And one of the things, you know, that sort of separates Dateline from other broadcasts or other kinds of journalism is, you know, you learn so much more about the victim, and the audience learns so much more about the victim, and then they also learn about the relationship that the victim had with their family, and maybe also the relationship that they had with the person who's accused of killing them. Mm. Because this, you know, as Dennis Murphy, is another correspondent on Dateline, sort of famously says, you know, it's not the murder, it's the marriage. That's what we end up looking at, and that's what police always end up looking at, is sort of, this is really about relationships. I mean, most people won't ever be the victim of violent crime, but everybody's been in a relationship that didn't end the way they wanted it to or thought it would.
Yeah.
And this is the story of relationships that end in, not just there, but like to extremes and in terrible places, and the crazy choices that some people make about how to get out of a relationship.
Well, that's one of the things that in watching the show that you think, my God, the depravity of some people.
Which I won't attempt to explain away. I mean, divorce is easy in this country. And yet there are people, and we see them all the time on Dateline, who choose another way out, who think that, I mean, I interviewed somebody who believed that he would do better with women if he were a widow, a widower, as opposed to if he'd been divorced.
Mm.
That sort of helped him navigate what to do in that situation. You do see some of the worst things that people do to each other, frequently to someone that they once loved, frequently to somebody who might be the parent of their children. It's astonishing.
And sometimes you sit across from them.
Yes.
We've seen the jailhouse interviews. Sometimes they're not even in jail yet, and this is the person who has committed this horrific murder. And they seem to want to convince you, Josh Mankiewicz, I didn't do it.
Yeah, they're always on their best behavior when they're talking with us. This is a conspiracy. I had nothing to do with the cops or and the prosecutors and my ex's family. They're all aligned together. It's all a big frame.
Yeah.
And in many cases, these are people who have declined to speak with law enforcement and didn't or won't take the stand in their own defense. So sometimes the interview that I'm doing is the only cross-examination they're ever going to get. So you listen to whatever their story is, no matter how preposterous it is, and then doesn't mean just because we're listening to it that we won't poke some holes in it, because we do.
Yeah. All right, when we come back, I want to talk to Josh about how this platform, Dateline, has changed his life. We'll be right back.
When you're a kid and you have fast food, it's a victory. When you're an adult and you have to have fast food, it's a crushing defeat.
Are you familiar with defeat?
My middle name.
Back with Josh Mankiewicz from Dateline. There you are with Keith Morrison. And I wanted to show one of those clips because it's crazy how you have become sort of like a pop culture thing.
It is crazy. I mean, again, I don't think any of us saw that coming. And Keith, who's phenomenally sort of shy in real life, really didn't see that coming. And yet he's by far the person sort of most associated with Dateline.
Keith is shy?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, he's really shy. Yeah.
I would never think that.
Yeah, he's Canadian, you know.
That explains nothing. Yeah. But it is strange. You go to like Crime Con.
Yeah.
And people line up.
Crime Con, the annual gathering of the true crime industry?
Yes.
That's about to have its fourth meeting in Orlando.
Thank you for that plug.
Crime Con, featuring value, selection, and economy. Tickets available at crimecon.com.
Endorsed by Josh Mankiewicz, apparently.
Yeah.
But they line up, they take pictures with you, and they know some of the stories that you've covered better than you do.
Oh, yeah. No. People at Crime Con and elsewhere, in airports, for example, say to me, "What happened on the mystery of the twisted trail?"
Right.
And I say, "Which one was that?" Because the titles are the only the part that I don't play any role in writing at all.
Right.
And then they say, "Oh, that was the guy who killed his wife." I'm like, "I'm going to need a little more than that."
Right, right.
Yeah. But people really want to know how they came out. Now, here's the interesting thing. When people ask me about a specific Dateline episode, they're never, almost never, talking about the one that aired this past Friday night live, the new one. They're talking about one of the repeats that airs all over the place on so many different cable platforms that, you know, good luck getting out of the way of seeing Dateline because it's playing everywhere.
Right.
And that's what people want to know about. So frequently they're asking about an episode that aired 3 or 4 years ago. And they want to know, "That guy get a new trial?" I'm like, I think so. Yeah.
You have no idea.
Sometimes I know. Sometimes
right,
I don't.
Right. I want to get back to something I talked to you about at the beginning, and this idea that you got into journalism following in the footsteps, really, of your father, Frank Mankiewicz, who was on the other side. He was a press secretary for Bobby Kennedy. Your brother, younger brother, Ben Mankiewicz, who people know from TCM, he's probably more famous than you are.
Oh, by far.
Certainly better looking. You could have gone one way with your career. You could have gone into politics. You could have gone into sort of, quote, mainstream journalism and stayed there. Are you satisfied with this choice? Has it been a good ride after 25 years?
Yeah, it's been wonderful. I mean, Dateline is a terrific place to work, and I alluded to this before, but the people you don't see, the producers, the editors, the camera crews, the managers, these are some of the best people that I've ever worked with. Mm. And that makes it a wonderful place to work. And everybody operates at such a high level that sort of for us, there's sort of no excuse for not doing a great interview and writing a great script, because everybody else is working at their absolute best. You know, I one of the benefits of having a really long career, because it's only 25 years at Dateline this year, it's 45 years overall. And I worked in three local stations and three TV networks. This is the best place to work. Dateline's been a wonderful home for me, and doing crime is something I didn't think I was going to like doing, but I do. Mm.
If you had a moment to sort of to think about, I want to step outside of the sort of the true crime reporting category, and this is the get that I want. This is the person I want to sit down with and do an interview with and really tell that story outside of crime. Is there such a person?
Well, it'd be great to sit down across from the president.
Any president or this particular?
The current president, but I don't somehow think that's going to happen. When he was alive, I always wanted to do Hugh Hefner, because he brought this huge change in America. He took sex from being dirty to being cool, and then in the end helped stoke this sexual revolution that sort of ran him over and nearly ran him out of business at the end. I thought he had some interesting perspectives on sort of what had happened in American life. The things we don't talk about are the things that I do want to talk about. I mean, domestic violence is in the backstory of so many Datelines that we do. But we generally just talk about this crime and what happened and how they solved it and how it gets disposed of. Mm-hmm. So stories about that kind of thing, those kind of issues. One of the things you see in Dateline is this wave of violence in this country that sort of doesn't really get reported. Yeah. Much of it by men, much of it against women. That's a kind of an untold story.
Well, Josh, thank you very much for spending some time with us. We asked some of our viewers and listeners to send in questions for you. We're going to continue that conversation on the audio podcast for Frank Buckley Interviews.
Thank you for having me, and can't wait for that.
And we want to tell our viewers that Dateline airs a new special every Friday on NBC at 9 p.m. We hope you'll watch that. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time.